Hey, what's going on, guys? This is Vance from Warframe God Builds, and today I'm joined by Aaron, Thomas, and Zachary. And to make things really short and simple, we're going to be explaining the Harrow trailer. So, I think out of the three of these guys that are joining me today, Zachary has the best idea of what's going on. So I'm just going to let him have the floor and explain it to these other stooges. Go ahead.
Okay, so, basically, what I got throughout this entire trailer was, if you start from the beginning, there is a, it's flashing in between the Anaros crypt from the Sons of Anaros questline. It's flashing in there, and it's kind of leading us into this whole end picture of Harrow being resurrected. But after we're shown the picture of Anaros, we are carried on through a new Harrow that walks into the Red Veil site in the relays with three Necroses. And these Necroses are following around this Harrow as if they are working for him, not really working with him per se, but just kind of like they're his slaves. Throughout this entire trailer, Harrow and these Necroses are going throughout the solar system and parts of the void, finding other Warframes and consuming, capturing their souls from these Warframes after they kill them. And that's not there's not really a motive behind it for a whole few little bit of the few minutes of the trailer. Once we get more in depth into the trailer, Harrow starts to make his way towards a burial site, which is where they are going to use these souls to resurrect the real Harrow. So the Harrow that we've been watching for the past four minutes, 45 seconds has been a prophet or a son of Harrow. And what I told Vance was that it felt like Harrow, the prophet of Harrow, was at least killing some sort of failed prophet or offspring of the original Harrow, normal Harrow, which they resurrect later on. That's the gist of the trailer that I got.
All right, so, well, I had a completely different take on it. I thought it was just some sort of space age, futuristic alien sex space orgy party or something like that.
Wow. Wow, okay.
And then Harrow's like, ah, fuck this is boring. So he goes outside and starts shooting some stuff. And then I actually thought maybe when the Chroma rocks up, because he appeared really big, I thought, oh yeah, maybe it was like, I don't know, like Godzilla or something. And then
I am so glad you caught that, the size difference between Chroma and Zephyr. I'm so glad you caught that, but carry on.
Yep. And then but I did get the when he starts taking souls, like the orbs that he starts sort of, you know, ripping out of their carcasses, so to speak. It actually reminds me a lot of none of you guys have probably seen it, and this is gonna show you how old I actually am. There was a movie from the 1990s. It's a really obscure movie. It's called Soul Taker. And it's basically about a guy who is kind of like the angel of death. Like when people die, he rocks up and he takes their souls and takes them off into the underworld. And then if you haven't seen it, which you probably haven't, I'd recommend going and checking it out. It's a really, really good movie. But yeah, that was kind of my weird take on it.
Well, unlike the Octavia trailer, where I did very little explaining at all, I feel obligated to actually further explain this one, because Octavia was really, really up to interpretation. Like, there was a loose script that was written, and there was room for someone to just kind of form their own opinion of what's going on. But with this one, there is a clear story going on here, so let me just fill in the blanks for anybody who's missing it. First of all, the one thing I want to talk about is why the Chroma was so much bigger than the Zephyr. Like I said, I'm so glad that you caught that. So, that was actually a reference to the old Nintendo game where you had the fancy little guns. You know what I'm talking about? It came on a cartridge. Yes.
Duck Hunt.
Yes. It was paying homage to Duck Hunt, because as soon as Harrow shot Zephyr out of the sky, you notice that Chroma jumped out of nowhere and grabbed Zephyr, and Harrow's like, well, this is convenient, because I need your soul too. And then he just pops Chroma. And it isn't revealed until, you know, after the Necrosis and the Harrow do their little dance. And this is kind of after the fact. The video kind of cuts around a lot, as Zachary mentioned. It kind of cuts to the end after they had already resurrected him. That's why you see the foreshadowing of what I'm going to say is Osiris. This is where the story gets fun to talk about, because not only is this Exitium canon, but this is also a continuation to an old Egyptian story that has to do with Set and Osiris.
So, the story between Set and Osiris is, Set and Osiris are sons of Amun-Ra, and that, so they are brothers, and they have a sister named Isis.
Not the terrorist group.
Not the terrorist group. Let's just say Isis, because I don't feel like Allah Akbar today. But, so, they had a sister named Isis and
Nefetis.
Nefetis, sorry, I...
Yeah, Egyptian names are weird anyway, so...
So, there were the four siblings of Amun-Ra, Nefetis, Isis, Osiris, and Set. Osiris had married their sisters, some, like, inbred Arkansas shit, married their sister... Isis, but Set also loved his sister Isis, who Osiris had already married. So Set one day made a sarcophagus for Osiris, which was looked upon as a great, great fortune, because death was worshipped by them in their times. And so Osiris had laid in this coffin that his brother had made for him, and Set sealed him inside and poured heated molten rock or magma, just something really hot that people don't like on their skin. And he, his brother, sealed him off inside of a tomb. And he died.
So, there is a whole lot more to the story. And there's also different interpretations. In a few interpretations, there was more siblings than just Set, Nefetis, Osiris, and Isis, but I primarily focus on the one that I favor the most. In other interpretations, he was cut in half, and then Isis had to find the pieces of Osiris to put him back together. And she did this soul mating thing, like she performed necrophiliasm, to be honest with you, and then she became impregnated with Horus, and that moves on. But for the trailer particularly, we're not going to focus on the rest of that story. We're just going to focus on the fact that Set pretty much betrayed Osiris. So what you're seeing here is that Set at the beginning of this trailer is actually talking to the viewer. He's speaking of how there's people coming from, like, you know, fallen, broken, simply dissolved into an incomplete thought, an empty shell cracked and disfigured. He's talking about how, you know, he came from the kingdom of Osiris, which it wasn't named that at the time because Osiris hadn't died. And when he betrayed Osiris, he basically had to go into hiding in one interpretation. In another interpretation, he reigned over the king of Osiris until Horus came and got his vengeance all Chuck Norris style. So the important takeaway that you could get from this is that it's a continuation of an Egyptian storyline. Egyptian mythology never got that far, and I just thought as an artist that, you know, I should add a sequel to Egyptian mythology. But what we haven't covered is what this could mean for the Exitium universe. Now, Thomas, I know you know about the conflict between Horus and the Anunnaki. I know there's a bit of explaining that you can do there to kind of show why it's important that Osiris returns.
So, Horus is the son of Osiris, and he was conceived in order to get revenge on Set. But he can't actually do this, since Set fled to the physical plane of existence, and he couldn't actually pursue Set, since a new threat had emerged at the time, and which are the Anunnaki, which, if you want an actual better explanation of the race themselves, you can check out the Dragon Ball Xenoverse God Builds for Elixir and Enlil. But moving forward, a character by the name of Eclipser, which is the brother to Elixir, who wants to resurrect the eternal Anakim because he actually believes that it could help him take over the kingdom of Osiris, but in reality it's actually like a weapon which could destroy everything in existence.
So to supply a little bit more detail on this eternal Anakim, I think I need to backstep and give more intel about the Anunnaki. So I hadn't really much talked about it a lot. I did a speed paint about it. It was Ta, the god of technology. He's actually like the god of creation or craftsmanship in Egyptian mythology. But of course, with Exitium, there's lots of things that's realistic, that's accurate to, you know, historical textbooks, and there's a ton of different mythologies that I draw inspiration from. So Ta, I did a speed paint on him, and I talked a little bit about him, I think, in the description, or I think it was actually in the video. But regardless, he's involved in a lot of stuff that's going on within this continuity. There is basically the first trials of the guilty in the halls of... it's called the Hall of Two Truths, I think is what it's called. And that's basically where your soul is judged in the afterlife. Anubis literally puts your soul on a balance beam with this feather called the Maat. And if your soul is heavier than the Maat, then you basically go to their equivalent of hell, which is the realm of the Twa. And if you're lighter than the feather, then you go to Hotep, which is heaven. So, basically...
He weighs your good deeds and your bad deeds, essentially.
Yeah, because basically the theory is that Ma is a genetic makeup of all of the contents that create the multiverse. Like, it has a genetic blueprint for everything that ever was. So, even though it's a feather, it's heavy as fuck. So, your soul is not supposed to be as heavy as the feather. But this is only one interpretation of Egyptian mythology. There's other things like you're supposed to carry good stuff like treasures with you into the afterlife, and you can bargain to go to heaven. But I'm primarily focusing on the one where your soul is tainted with sin. If your soul is tainted with sin, enough of it anyways, your soul will be heavier than the Maat, and you'll go to hell, and you'll live a sentencing. Well, basically, during the first couple of trials, there was an act that was so vile, so bizarre and appalling that Ta left the Order of the Mechezdet. He completely left, and he went to the physical plane just like Set had done, but he did it with a totally different intention. He did it with the intention to raise humanity up to the point where they could overthrow the gods. So you see in the pattern here, basically everyone is trying to overthrow the kingdom of Osiris. Like, everyone wants to win over the access to heaven. Like, everyone wants to be in charge of that. So Ta has this, he has this agenda. He wants to force human evolution. He wants to build them up. So he's actually the leader of Starcom, our clan. Like, our clan isn't just a clan outside, like in Warframe, like in the social world. It's a clan inside of the Exitium universe. Like, their Starcom is a really big, massive, spiraling, like an intergalactic government, if you will. And he's the leader of them. And he wants only to overthrow the Kingdom of Osiris. So what he actually did is he took Wukong, he took the blood of Wukong, and kind of made like a homunculus creature out of different enzymes to create the Anunnaki. He raised them on this planet called Nibiru. And when he raised them, they kind of got out of control. They became too powerful for their own good. He couldn't control them anymore, which is why he created Enlil. Enlil is kind of like a surrogate for Taw's will. He created Enlil with the purpose to kind of spy on the Anunnaki because, like I said, they're way too powerful now. You've got Eclipser now who can actually defy Horus. He can stand up to him. He's in control of his own molecules, so he can't be physically beaten by Horus. It's kind of like two forces that just can't cancel each other out.
The irresistible force versus the immovable object.
Exactly. They're at a stalemate. So Horus is literally preoccupied dealing with the Anunnaki threat, because it's a stalemate, and he can't pursue Set. So, at this point, Taw had created these things, and they've gotten way out of his control, and that's when, they develop their own will. And they too want to take over the kingdom of Osiris, but they don't want to give it to Taw, they want to rule it over for themselves. So you got everybody, it's a constant power struggle for the afterlife. Everybody's trying to get access to it. So that's basically what's going on.
He actually he reminds me a bit of the story of like Prometheus in Greek mythology. Like he gave fire to man so man could even though Prometheus was a titan, he was like pro mankind sort of thing, so it reminds me a little bit of that.
Well. I did take a lot of inspiration to create stories like this, like the Anunnaki. We talked about it off recording, but the Anakim, it's a realistic term. Like, scientists in the real world believe that the Anakim were an alien civilization that were once on Earth. There's a ton of information. If you just type it in, Anakim, you'll see a bunch of, man discovers giants that once inhabited Earth. I took inspiration from that to make these actual giants in the Exitium universe that are a big threat. So I'm pretty sure at that point you had a lot of questions to ask me.
So in like relation to the Anakim, like what's sort of is there like an even bigger evil or force that's actually behind them?
So Exitium has this one principle that it lives by. For every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. And basically what's going on here is that for everything that Amun-Ra had created, there was a negative creation that formed because of it. So when he created his children, Set, Isis, Osiris, all of them, and he created the physical world, he accidentally created the Anakim. And so they're like beings the size of planets. They're literally like Galactus from Marvel Comics, but there's a civilization of them. And they move throughout the multiverse, they move throughout the realms of possibility. Because if you research quantum mechanics, there's a bunch of dimensions, and each dimension dictates a different possibility, like ripples in water. So progressively, they're moving throughout all the different realities and destroying them. Destroying the planets, destroying the galaxies. That's what the Anakim do. They feed on existence. They pull planets apart and feed on their core. And it eventually collapses reality, but the overall Anakim, like the just the mainstream Anakim that you see throughout most of the continuity, they're not powerful enough to rip a reality open on their own. That's why we foreshadow the Eternal Anakim so much, because this is the granddaddy of them all. This is the megalode. This is so again. Going back to that principle of for every action there is an equal and opposite reaction, because Amun-Ra exists, the Eternal Anakim is the answer. He is the negative equivalent to that. Whereas Amun-Ra created everything, the Eternal Anakim will destroy everything. It's like a force of nature. It can't be controlled. It's not discriminative towards anything. If Eclipser resurrects the Eternal Anakim, he will destroy reality, period. No questions about it. The Anakim throughout Exitium lore does demonstrate free will from time to time, but the Eternal Anakim is a totally different beast in of itself. it's almost as if he has this impulse to destroy reality. And there is a twist to that story, but I can't spoil it. And I think that you had asked me about my inspirations earlier. You had asked me if I had heard about that story.
Oh, yeah. The Russian-American author, Zachariah Sitchin, he essentially like Nibiru and the Anunnaki, they're from another planet, etc. Mm-hmm. He actually, you could take it as like his own mythology, but he actually purported it to like be real per se. But yeah, you could just like look at it as it's his mythology sort of thing. But that's probably a whole other video. But yeah,
Definitely. Well, from what I know about Nibiru, the actual like astronomical theories is that Nibiru doesn't just share our orbit. It could actually be on an orbit like that's unique. Like so basically the sun and everything in the Milky Way is spinning at a certain axis, and it's theorized that Nibiru could have an egg-shaped orbit. So, you know, once it gets to the height of the pointy part of the egg, it'll revolve around our sun. But once it makes that turn and gets around our sun, it'll shoot back out to the other galaxy that it orbits and move around that sun. And so this raises a lot of different questions, because if you're familiar with the movie, I forget the name of it. It's where they go into the black hole.
Actually, it's on like the tip of my... It's like just a recent one.
Yeah, it was. Matthew McConaughey.
Matthew McConaughey, yeah. It was,
Yeah, Interstellar, that's what it was.
Yeah, he goes into the black hole at the end, yeah. And there's actually, aliens that have built a construct within the black hole for him to actually go back in time, or...
Yeah,
something.
But that's not the part that I'm referencing. Yeah, yeah. The part that I'm referencing is when they went on... You remember how when they landed on the planet's surface, they couldn't spend a whole lot of time there because too much time would have passed on Earth?
That's right, because of relativity.
Yes, exactly. So the theory in Exitium Universe is that Nibiru, doesn't actually just share an orbit. It also shares two different dimensions. It's kind of like the loophole. It's kind of like the way... Like, if you wanted to get to the physical reality, you could just ride on Nibiru. Like, you could sit on Nibiru, like, on one of these years that it passes by our orbit, you could jump to Nibiru, and then when it goes and revolves back around to wherever it comes from, it actually goes into another dimension, and this is how you can, like, you basically take a taxi to the Kingdom of Osiris. It goes to the spiritual, it actually goes to a pocketed dimension. So, and that's the gateway to the realm of Hotep. Like, it sits on this little, it's kind of like a funnel, you know, the whole universe ends at one point, and the only way to go forward is through the Kingdom of Osiris. So Nibiru actually goes there, it taxis you. But the thing about the Kingdom of Osiris is that if you spend, let's say, a day there, it will be equivalent to maybe 10 years back on Earth. So even though Set left the Kingdom of Osiris like a minute ago, it's been, you know, he's had 100 something, he's had actually multiple millennia to be on Earth and to hide from Osiris and Horus. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
The moment he left that pocketed dimension, time was in his favor. He was able to flee from Horus and basically have like 100 lifetimes to plan his next course of attack, whereas Horus had only minutes. He had only minutes to plan what he was going to do about Set. And then all of a sudden, the Kingdom of Osiris goes under attack, and Horus has to, you know, he's preoccupied with the Anunnaki. He's preoccupied with Eclipser and Elixir and all the other Anunnaki that were trying to take over the Kingdom of Osiris. that is ultimately why Osiris is resurrected in this trailer. Because there is a cult following, which I'm sure everybody knows. There's definitely an occult in this trailer, like Zachary had mentioned earlier. They are trying to resurrect Osiris. And they're doing so because they're basically under the command of Horus. They're the heralds of the gods. So they do the bidding of... They do the dirty work of the gods. And they went and slaughtered, you know, enough essential souls in order to resurrect Osiris. Because, like I said with Exitium, it takes a lot of realistic, historically accurate stories, but it twists them. So it's taking the realistic story, the Egyptian mythos story of Horus fighting Set, and it's twisting it. Instead of Horus actually doing battle with Set, they actually resurrect Osiris, and Osiris is going to go to Earth to do battle with Set.
I like the whole time displacement thing, not only as a plot device for your story, but also the fact that it's scientific, it's theoretically possible, because that makes it interesting.
That's what many people don't realize about the Exitium universe. They think that it might just be like a story that's formed for the sake of entertainment, like Dragon Ball Z or Dragon Ball Super. What people don't know about the Exitium universe is that it's very scientific. What I don't want to just inspire upcoming artists like myself. Like, growing up, I had Power Rangers and Dragon Ball Z, and we had that movie Donnie Darko. We had The Fourth Kind. Like, I had a lot of great things to inspire me and make me want to naturally learn on my own. And that's what I'm trying to do for the younger generation that watches anything I produce within the Exitium universe. I want them to accidentally learn through my storylines. I want them to actually, like, have their taste buds wet. You know, I want them to salivate over scientific facts, quantum mechanics, theories of relativity. You know, things that interest me, things that I incorporate in my writing to make a really entertaining story.
That's what I like about it. You're combining sort of the science fiction aspects of a lot of different stories, but you've also sort of thrown in, you know, metaphysical concepts and, you know, sort of spirituality, quote unquote, sort of thing. That's what I like about it. I haven't really, at the moment, there's not really anything out there that's doing the same thing to the extent, like, yeah, that's what I personally like about it as a fan, so, yeah.
So it's going right around 30 minutes of this video, and I think, and I can actually say that I believe that we fully explained this trailer, whereas the Octavia trailer that we explained, it didn't fully explain anything. It just provoked more questions. So, that being said, is there anything else that you guys want to ask before we close this out?
So with the whole different dimensions and them being in different timelines, for instance, like you said, a day on Earth or a day in this other planet is a 10 years on Earth.
Mm-hmm.
So would that mean that Set knows about the ongoing issue in the Kingdom of Osiris between the Anunnaki and Horus?
Well, that's a good question. I'm going to have to swerve it because he's actually involved with a totally different storyline. Like, he's involved... I'm just gonna say it. He's involved with the Eight Accursed storyline, which I know you're not familiar with that, but I know that's gonna ring a bell to a couple of my viewers, maybe more than a couple. So, I think that Set, because how would he know? You know, just because he's a god, they have to go through loopholes to actually get to the physical world. The gods, they... So, you have this spirit... the spiritual body, which is kind of like gas, you know, it's not solid form. You gotta consider that Hotep, heaven, is a realm of energy, and that's all it is energy. Nothing has physical bodies. So in order for these gods to exist on that plane and then come over to the physical plane of existence, they actually have a physical, they need to have a physical body to do that. that limits their power, and that takes away all of their titles. Titles are very, very important. I'm not going to explain it here. I will explain it at a later date. But, like, being the god of sky or the god of creation, that's an actual physical title, and it amplifies their power. But when they don't have it, they're limited. And something that also limits them is having a physical body. So when Set inhabits a physical body, and he goes to the physical plane, he is very limited. He's still really powerful. Like, he could raffle stomp an army of humans, especially to the time frame that he went to. Like, he went back in time to the Crusades, like the 1200s. So he's not gonna get, like, he has nothing to worry about there. But I would say, to answer your question, I would say that he has no clue of what's going on in the Kingdom of Osiris after he left. Because he would have no way of knowing. Because he's limited.
Yes, and so I have another one.
Okay, shoot.
With Osiris, you said it's sort of like a, with every action has an equal and opposite reaction, so when Osiris was made, his name escapes me. He was made. The Anakins. They were made. So then does that mean for, even with them, is there an equal and opposite reaction for everybody, or is it just Osiris that there's an equal and opposite reaction for?
Okay, so anytime there's something that's created out of nothing, it's gonna spawn something, essentially. Because energy is neither created or destroyed. That's one of the laws of physics, is that, I think it's Newton's first law? Don't quote me, because I'm not too sure. But I believe it's Newton's first law. Energy is neither created or destroyed. It's simply displaced. So that's the theory here, is that, even though Amun-Ra is creating something from nothing, he's still, it's got its consequences. So anytime something is created, it basically creates two. Amun-Ra creating his children, he accidentally created the Anakim. And the Anakim are, you know, they exist to do the opposite of what Amun-Ra's children exist to do. Amun-Ra basically created his children so that they could maintain the stability of all the different dimensions, all the different planes of existence. To give you more backstory of Amun-Ra in the Exitium universe, you gotta think of him as a child. He was like a child playing The Sims. He wasn't trying to be this omnipotent, godlike being. He was simply trying to entertain himself. He came out of nothing. He came out of blackness. So he lit up the night sky with his energy, and he realized that, you know, his energy would cool down and become planets and become galaxies, and he was like, oh, this is cool. So then he beamed his consciousness down to these planets to see what kind of life he had accidentally created. And when he did that, well, there was, you know, creating humans led to the creation of demons. And these demons inhabited the same plane of existence as the humans. So demons were doing horrible things to the humans. They were raping them, eating them, and he thought this was horrible. So he decided to separate the dimensions. And when he separated the dimensions, he also created his children so that his children would make sure that the dimensions are never breached. This action right here was referred to as the first breach. There is a second breach later on down the line, but again, another topic for another time.
Okay.
Basically, anytime there's a creation god and he creates something, it has a negative fall off. Because you have to take energy to make something. You know, energy is not, it's not created and it's not destroyed. Amun-Ra is living energy. So in a way, he's not creating anything. He's just transplanting. He's transplanting aspects of himself. We, in astronomy, are referred to as star children. Like, humans are referred to as star children. Because we all came from the energy that resulted from, quote-unquote, the Big Bang. And that's basically what Amun-Ra is. He's a super sun. He's a sun the size... He's bigger than imagination. If you saw him face to face, your eyeballs would explode and catch fire, because just the sheer size of him is too much for your existence to handle. In different interpretations, he's known only as Amun, but in alternate interpretations, he's known only as Ra. This is because he actually created a physical body for himself to live amongst his people at one point in time. There's this thing called the All-Seeing Eye, and multiple gods have possessed it throughout the mythology. It started with Amun-Ra, then at one point in time, Sobek merged with Amun-Ra, and they became Sobek-Ra. At one point in time, Ra gave the eye to Horus. So if you ever hear the Eye of Horus, it's not somebody bullshitting you, like it's a real thing. These titles can be given to multiple people. It's kind of like powers, you know? You can just... It's like if a power were a physical box and you could give it to somebody, maybe like the Green Lantern, you could like give your ring to someone. That's kind of like what a title is. But again, yet another story for a different time.
Ties into thermodynamics. It's interesting.
Alright, so, as I always encourage you to do, if you like this video, rate, share, subscribe, send it to all your friends. And until next time, this has been Vance signing out. These are these guys signing out. Peace.